for coming out on a Sunday afternoon. Spend some time with your closest 130 vegan friends and Dr. Michael Greger. First of all, I need to thank Kaiser Permanente for providing the rooms for us and also for an unrestricted educational grant so that we could have Dr. Greger come by. And I also want to thank Linda Middlesworth, our local vegan champion. And I guess she's always calling me up. She goes, "He's coming again. Can you guys do it down there again?" So I say, "Of course, we'll give it a try." So at any rate, I'm Andrew Klonicki. I'm a nuclear medicine physician at Kaiser Permanente. And you might wonder, well, what is a nuclear medicine physician doing dabbling in nutrition? From a very personal point of view, I think it's very important. And I think it's certainly very important for our patients. I think that what we eat has a lot to do with how we feel physically. So this is Rocky at Dr. Freud's office. When I learned you are what you eat, I realized I was nuts. So we're not going to become nuts if we eat plant-based, but we might become a little healthier, and I think that's really an important thing for us. And it was kind of interesting. I heard this statistic that mammals live approximately 10 times their age at puberty. And so since most of us go through puberty around 12 to 14, we should live to between 120 to 140. And there are places in the world where people do live to that age, but obviously not in the United States. So this particular individual and his group kind of looked at it and they said, well, why is it that people die before their assigned time? And they came up with this particular schema. Some of it's bad luck, you're born with genes, although I think when we start looking at it, we know that actually our diet can overcome our genetics, so that may be too big a pile. Social circumstances, people that are in a poor socioeconomic situation have a difficult time getting good nutrition, so that may actually be nutritional as well. Environmental exposure, that's tough, that's just bad luck sometimes. Healthcare, I'm hoping that means that lack of access to, rather than they came to us and we did them in. Although I think you spoke to that a couple of years back. Then behavioral patterns. But how we behave really has a lot to do with why people die prematurely. I'm going to get you bad here. So if you start looking at what kind of behaviors cause these premature deaths, now this is a little dated, it's from 2000, so I'm going to say that since there's been this big campaign to quit smoking, that probably smoking is probably a smaller group at this time, and obesity and inactivity, which are really nutritional illnesses, is probably accounting for more of the premature deaths than anything else. So then the question that you want to ask yourself is that if poor eating is causing us to die earlier, what kind of poor eating is doing that? Well, in the United States, the two leading causes of death are heart disease and cancers. And if you look around the world, there seems to be an inverse relationship to whether you die from cancer and heart disease and how many of your calories you're eating from unrefined plant foods. And so you see the darker column, that's a greater percentage of the diet is coming from unrefined plant foods. And so there's an inverse relationship. The more processed food you eat and less plant food you eat, the higher your risk of dying from heart disease and cancer. Hungary leads the pack 90%. They get about 10% of their diet from plant-based unrefined foods. And we're pretty close behind to them. But look at what happens in Korea, Thailand, and Laos. They're eating almost a completely plant-based diet, and their death from cardiac diseases and cancers is significant lower than what happens here. So the question then becomes, why do we do that? And I think part of it is a lack of knowledge, but part of it is that we're bombarded by all of these external marketing forces at all times. The Got Milk campaign was probably the best marketing campaign that ever happened in the history of the world. And the California Milk Board had to react to the introduction of soft drinks and sodas. because they were being taken, they were being handed their lunch by the soft drink manufacturers. So they started contributing a few pennies per gallon, and they came out with the Got Milk slogans. And so certainly, there's not a single person in the world that wouldn't want to look like Superman. Right? I mean, there's a veiled message here, but you know, drink some milk and you'll be strong and good looking and handsome like Superman. But and all of the, and we're bombarded by this relative to all the food that we eat, whether it's the beef industry or you know the cage-free egg chickens, you know, eggs with better omega-3 fatty acids, you know, and so forth. So, you know, we get hit with a lot of information that's not helpful to us. And you know, as far as milk goes, it's kind of interesting to me because, you know, even grown-up cattle won't drink milk. I mean, you know, why do we have this fascination with dairy products? They're certainly very happy on a plant-based diet. And this is, you know, I used to show this little cartoon because people would say, where do you get your protein? And so certainly, this is a very happy cow here without having to worry about eating any of the animal products. The other problem that we have is the people that want to sell us drugs. And I read a statistic someplace that the Americans take 46% of the prescription drugs given in the world. You know, that's a lot, you know. And the problem is that it's advertisements such as this. You know, it says gout's root cause is high uric acid. Well, not exactly. You know, you get high uric acid. Most people get high uric acid. It's because of how they eat. But of course, if they said, you know, change your diet, you know, then they wouldn't be able to sell this expensive uric acid lowering drug. So we're bombarded by, you know, can't we just take some medicine for the ailments that we have instead of trying to treat our diseases with better nutrition? So who can you trust? I get my spices at the health food store. They do have good spices at the health food store, but it's very interesting to me because there's always some guy walking around in a white coat with four or five people, and there's something for everybody. And this stuff is not cheap, so that's probably not the place. Your doctor? Maybe not. You know, so if, you know, and you can ask some simple questions, you know, ask them if they've heard of the American College of Lifestyle Medicine, ask them what they eat, ask them if they've heard of the China study. You know, and if, you know, if you're getting the sense that they know absolutely nothing about nutrition, then you probably want to see somebody else. But there are some very, very good sites where you can get great information. Physicians Committee on Responsible Medicine, PCRM.org, weekly email, medical information, good studies, good recipes, forks over knives, a lot of inspirational stories, great recipes. And then there's this kind of unusual site called nutritionfacts.org. And of course, that's why we're all here today to hear Dr. Gregory Spider of nutritionfacts.org. And we're very fortunate that he's decided to stop. For those of you who don't know, he studied agriculture at Cornell, went to medical school at Tufts. He's a general practitioner, but his interest is clinical nutrition. And his job is to do something, discover the world's literature, find out everything we need to know about nutrition, and tell us so we don't have to do it. Dr. Greger, thanks so much for coming to see us.
Thank you for that great introduction. Steal my clicker? Clicker stealer.
We have our own. You gonna use ours?
Can I just have?
Let me tell you about cognitive dysfunction. Oh, did you put it? That's where you hid it.
Put it in the drawer.
Put it in the drawer. So, for those of you unfamiliar with my work, every year I read through every issue of every English language nutrition journal in the world, so you don't have to. Every year my talks are brand new because every year the science is brand new. I then compile all the most interesting, most groundbreaking, most practical findings of the new videos and articles I upload every day to my nonprofit site, nutritionfacts.org. Everything on the website is free. and no ads, no corporate sponsorships, strictly non-commercial, not selling anything. Just put it up as a public service, a labor of love for all. New videos and articles every day on the latest in evidence-based nutrition. What a concept. In my 2012 review, which I think I gave in this very room a few years ago, I explored the role a healthy diet may play in preventing, arresting, and reversing our deadliest diseases. In 2013, our covered most common conditions. 2014, our most common causes of disability. And this year, what I'd like to do is address some of our most dreaded diseases, which, according to the latest Gallup poll, cancer tops the list. Number one cancer killer in the United States for both men and women is lung cancer. If you look at the rates of lung cancer around the world, you see that they vary by a factor of 10. You say, wait a second. If there's nothing you can do to prevent lung cancer, it just kind of happened at random, you'd assume the rates everywhere would be about the same. But the fact there's such a huge variation in rates, you assume that there's some kind of contributing cause, and indeed, we now know 90% of cases smoking is responsible. So if we don't want to die from the number one cancer killer by just not smoking, we can throw 90% of our risk out the window. Colorectal cancer, second leading cause of cancer death in this country, for which there's an even bigger spread. So it appears colon cancer doesn't just happen, something makes it happen. Well, if our lungs can get filled with carcinogens from smoke, maybe our colons are getting filled with carcinogens from food. Why do African Americans, for example, get more colon cancer than native Africans? Why that population? Because colon cancer is extremely rare in native African populations. We're talking 50 times lower rates than Americans, white or black. Now, we used to think it was all the fiber that they were eating. However, the modern African diet is actually highly processed, low in fiber, and yet there's been this no dramatic increase in colon cancer. So that must not have been what it was. And we're not talking just low fiber intakes these days in Africa. We're talking United States of America low fiber intakes, like half the recommended daily minimum intake. Yet colon cancer still remains rare in Africa. So 50 times less colon cancer. All right. Maybe it's because they're thinner and exercise more. No, they're not, and no, they don't. If anything, the physical activity may be even lower. So wait a second. If they're sedentary like us, eating mostly refined carbs like us, right? A few whole plant foods, little fiber like us, why do they have 50 times less colon cancer? Well, there is one big difference. The diet of both Africans and African Americans and Caucasian Americans is rich in meat, whereas Native African diet is so low in meat and saturated fat content that the total average cholesterol levels come in at about 139 average total cholesterol compared to over 200 here in the U.S. So yeah, they don't get a lot of fiber anymore, but they continue to minimize meat and animal fat consumption, supporting evidence that perhaps the most powerful determinant of colon cancer risk are levels of meat and animal fat intake. So why do Americans get more colon cancer? Maybe the rarity of colon cancer in sub-Saharan Africa is associated with their low animal product consumption. But why? Have you ever saw that takeoff of the industry slogan, beef, it's what's for dinner? Beef, it's what's rotting in your colon. I saw this in if you see it, the screen is yellow. Sorry about this. I'm sorry, I've got to pull this out for a moment. There we go. As you saw, my screen was yellowing, and that's because in the East Coast, it is getting dark outside. And that's where I live, and it's good not to have blue light flooding into your eyes when it's supposed to be dark outside. And so my computer is smart enough to try to preserve my melatonin. All right, let's see how that works. Does it still look kind of yellow?
Yeah.
Looks okay on my screen. Well, maybe we can dim the lights here. How did we do that? There's a cool way to do that here. Presentation. Lights. How did you dim the lights before? Do you remember? Right here, just the bank here. You can hardly see that at all.
Oh,
I'm going to
spot right there on the wall.
Change the time on your computer.
Well, we can't. The screen is backlit.
We can see it.
You kind of see it? All right.
That's
fine. Now you can't. You still see the screen? Can you? It's a little better.
Yeah.
All right, we'll go with that. Sorry. Okay. Where are we? Oh, yeah. Where's my call? There we go. So, you know, I saw this at a party with some friends once, and I was such the party pooper, no pun intended, and explained to everybody that no, meat is completely digested in the small intestine. None of it makes it down the colon. You know, it's no fun to hang out with biology geeks, but it turns out I was wrong. Turns out 12 grams of protein a day can escape digestion, and when it reaches the colon, it can be turned into a toxic substances like ammonia. This degradation of undigested protein in the colon is called putrefaction. So a little bit of meat does end up putrefying in our colon. And the problem is some of the byproducts of this putrefaction process can be toxic. Same thing happens with other animal proteins. You eat egg whites, for example. Some of that can putrefy too. But you say, wait a second, there's protein in plants too. The difference is that animal proteins tend to have more sulfur-containing amino acids like methionine, just found concentrated actually mostly in chicken and fish and eggs, less in red meat and dairy. But if you really want to stick with low methionine foods, you got to stick with plants. And then methionine can be turned into hydrogen sulfide in a colon, a rotten egg gas, which doesn't just smell bad, but can produce changes that increase cancer risk. There's a divergence of opinion as to whether it's the animal fat, the cholesterol, or the animal protein that's increasing the cancer risk, as they all can have carcinogenic properties. But it doesn't really matter since the diet rich in one tends to be rich in the others by default. The protein does more than just putrefy, though. Animal protein consumption causes an increase in the blood levels of a cancer-promoting growth hormone called IGF-1, insulin-like growth factor 1. But remove meat, egg white, and dairy proteins from the diet, and our bloodstream can suppress cancer cell growth about 8 times better. This is an effect so powerful that Ornish and colleagues appeared able to reverse the progression of prostate cancer without chemosurgery or radiation, just a plant-based diet and other healthy lifestyle changes. The link between animal protein and IGF-1 may help explain why those eating low-carb diets tend to die sooner, but not just any low-carb diet, specifically those based on animal sources, whereas vegetable-based low-carb diets were not associated, were actually associated with a lower risk of death. But you know, look, high meat, low carb diets are high in animal fat as well as the animal protein. So a lot of me think it was the animal protein and not the saturated fat and cholesterol that was killing people off. Well, I mean, what we would need is a study, you know, that follows a few thousand people out for 20 years or so, following them and their protein intakes, and then, you know, see who gets cancer, who doesn't, who lives longer, who doesn't. But there'd never been a study like that until now. 6,000 men and women over age 50 across the U.S. fall for 18 years, and those under age 65 with high protein intake, 75% increase in overall mortality, 4-fold increase in the risk of dying from cancer. But not all proteins, specifically animal protein, which makes sense given the higher IGF-1 levels in those eating excess protein. Animal protein increases IGF-1 levels, which increases cancer risk. The sponsoring university sent out a press release with a famous, kind of memorable opening line: that chicken wing you're eating could be as deadly as a cigarette. Explaining that a diet high in animal proteins during middle age makes you 4 times more likely of dying from cancer mortality risk, which is kind of on par with smoking. You know, almost everyone's going to have a cancer cell, precancer cell in them at some point. The question is, does it progress? And that may depend on what we eat. Most malignant tumors are covered in IGF-1 receptors, just waiting to get stimulated. But if there's less IGF-1 around, they may not be able to progress. And it wasn't just more deaths from cancer. Middle-aged people eating lots of protein from animal sources found to be more susceptible to early death in general. Crucially, the same did not apply to plant proteins like beans. And it wasn't the fat, the animal protein that appeared to be the culprit. So what was the response to this revelation that diets high in meat, eggs, and dairy could be as harmful to health as smoking? Well, one nutrition scientist replied that it was wrong and potentially dangerous. Not the discovery that animal protein was killing people, but the way they were telling people about it. It could damage the effectiveness of public health campaigns, public health messages. You know, a smoker might think, oh, why bother quitting if, you know, a ham and cheese sandwich is going to be just as bad for me, so I'll keep smoking. That reminds me of a famous Philip Morris ad, cigarette ad, that tried to downplay the risk by saying, you think secondhand smoke is bad, increasing the risk of lung cancer 19%. Right, drinking 1 or 2 glasses of milk every day, maybe 3 times as bad, 62% increased risk of lung cancer. Or doubling the risk frequently cooking with oil, or tripling your risk of heart disease by eating non-vegetarian, or multiplying your risk 6-fold eating lots of meat and dairy. Right? So they conclude, look, let's keep some perspective here, right? I mean, the risk of lung cancer from secondhand smoke may be well below the risk reported for other everyday activities, so breathe deep. That's like saying, don't worry about getting stabbed, because getting shot is so much worse. How about neither? Two risks do not make a right. Of course, you'll notice when Philip Morris bought Kraft, they stopped throwing dairy under the bus. Next on the list of dreaded diseases is heart disease. It's not appreciated until recently that the average cholesterol in the United States, so-called normal level, actually abnormal, accelerated blockages in arteries, putting a large fraction of the population at risk. Having a normal cholesterol in a society where it's normal to drop dead of a heart attack, or number one killer, not necessarily a good thing. Normal cholesterol levels can be fatal cholesterol levels. Why does it matter? We have lots of cholesterol circulating in our bloodstream. Well, it doesn't just infiltrate our arteries and help form these inflamed kind of pockets of pus in our arterial walls, but may play an active role in the final fatal plaque rupture. Cholesterol crystals may actually pop the plaque. If you look at ruptured arteries from autopsies, ruptured plaques filled with cholesterol crystals protruding out from the plaque. Cholesterol in the plaque may get so super saturated at a recent point where it crystallizes like rock candy, and the growing crystals may then kind of burst the plaque open. Here's a cholesterol crystal shooting out the top of the test tube. When you look at the tips of the cholesterol crystals under a microscope, they're sharp, jagged needles. They place a thin membrane over the top of the test tube to see if the cholesterol needles would poke through, and indeed, they showed that the cholesterol crystals cut through the membrane. So they showed that as cholesterol crystallizes, right, the volume increases, and then the sharp-tipped crystals can cut through and tear a membrane, suggesting that the crystallization of the supersaturated cholesterol is what means rupture in atherosclerotic plaques, and that's what we see on autopsy. All people that died from acute heart attacks, MIs, had perforated cholesterol crystals like this sticking out of their plaques, but no crystals were found perforating the plaques of those people with severe heart disease that had died from non-cardiac causes, like get by a bus or something before they had their heart attack. So this can explain why dramatically lowering cholesterol levels with diet and drugs if necessary can reduce the risk of fatal heart attacks by pulling cholesterol out of the artery wall, decreasing the risk of crystallizing these cholesterol needles that may pop the plaques in our artery. High cholesterol is also can also cause what's called fatty liver disease. Our next global chronic disease epidemic, fatty deposits in the liver can trigger inflammation, result in liver cancer, failure, and death. And again, it may be these crystals, cholesterol crystals, triggering this progression from fatty liver to serious hepatitis. We're talking dietary cholesterol, the cholesterol people eat from foods like eggs and other animal products. Strong association between cholesterol intake and hospitalization and death from cirrhosis and liver cancer. And beyond just the crystals, dietary cholesterol can oxidize and directly have toxic carcinogenic effects. In cholesterol lowering, moderation kills. Even if all Americans kept their total cholesterol under the recommended 200, right, millions would develop coronary artery disease. Strong evidence shows we need to keep our total cholesterol under the target of 150 to stem the epidemic. What kind of evidence? Well, in many cultures, coronary disease is practically unheard of when we see total cholesterol levels in the population under 150. Here in the U.S., the famous Framingham Heart Study, few under 150 developed heart disease and none died from it. We cannot continue to have public and private organizations on the forefront of health leadership recommend to the public a dietary plan that recommends that millions will continue to perish from the very disease the guidelines were supposed to prevent. The reason given by health authorities for not telling people the truth, for not advocating for what the science shows is best, is that it might frustrate the public, who might have difficulty maintaining their lower level. But maybe the public's greatest frustration would be not being informed about the optimal diet for health. Heart disease can be reversed with a plant-based diet. The evidence justifies igniting a social movement. Let the people lead, and eventually the government may follow. Some criticize plant-based diets as extreme. If you want extreme, though, check out the consequences of our present diet, like having a breastbone sawed in half, or a bypass surgery, or a stroke rendering one mute, or having a breast, prostate, colon, rectum removed to treat cancer. That's extreme. Eating a bean burrito, that's easy. Instead of just bypassing the problem, literally, you can treat the cause. Arrest and reverse heart disease, our number one killer, with a whole food, plant-based diet. Next on the list is arthritis, such as rheumatoid arthritis, a chronic systemic inflammatory disorder, can cause progressive destruction of the joints. As many as 80% become disabled, may cut up to 18 years off of one's lifespan. There are drugs people can take, unfortunately often associated with severe side effects, blood loss, bone loss, toxicity of the liver, eyes, immune suppression, etc. There's got to be a better way. Well, you know, there were hints early on. Populations eat more meat, do they tend to have higher levels of rheumatoid arthritis? There's been some dramatic case reports of rheumatoid arthritis attacks triggered by animal protein consumption, starting about 6 to 10 hours after a meal and lasting a few days, but they stopped when the patient stopped eating animal products. The researchers suggest that immune complexes formed by the body attacking animal proteins may provoke these autoimmune reactions within the joints themselves. And indeed, those with rheumatoid arthritis had striking elevations in antibodies to foods like fish, pork, egg whites, dairy proteins, and even some cereals. It could also possibly be a pro-inflammatory property of meat fats or free radicals from the iron accumulating in the joints or other mechanisms. But look, case reports and country-by-country comparisons really just raise questions. You can't, I mean, to prove cause and effect, you need an interventional study, right, to put it to the test. And here we go. 13-month-long randomized controlled trial, plant-based diets, rheumatoid arthritis. People put on a vegan diet for 3.5 months and switched to an egg-free vegetarian diet for the remainder, compared to the control group that didn't change their diet. Plant-based group had a significant improvement in morning stiffness within the first month, cutting the number of hours they suffered from joint stiffness in half, a drop in pain, a drop in disability. They reported subjectively feeling better, significant improvement in grip strength, fewer tender joints, less tenderness per joint, less swelling. They also had a drop in inflammatory markers like C-reactive protein, Z-rate, white count. Highly significant, clinically relevant finding. What about osteoarthritis? Most frequent cause of physical disability among older adults, affecting about 20 million Americans, with 20% of us estimated to be affected in the coming decades, becoming more and more widespread among younger people. It's characterized by loss of cartilage in the joint. We used to think it was just kind of mechanical wear and tear, but now it's generally accepted that to be an active joint disease, permanent inflammatory component. Well, if the loss of cartilage is due to inflammation, maybe if we put people on an anti-inflammatory diet, it would help, like it did with rheumatoid arthritis. Using optimum nutrition and exercise as the first-line intervention could well constitute the best medical practice. So what's the best science as to what optimal nutrition might look like? Well, China studies, prime example, showing the serious health consequences of high consumption of pro-inflammatory foods, meat, dairy, fat, and junk, and low consumption of anti-inflammatory plant foods, whole grains, vegetables, fruits, beans, split peas, chickpeas, lentils. The unnatural Western diet contributes to low-grade systemic inflammation, oxidative tissue stress, and irritation, placing the immune system in this overactive state, which can be a common denominator for inflammatory conditions such as arthritis. Next on the list is stroke and high blood pressure, which go together because high blood pressure is the number one risk factor for stroke. The PREDIMED study found that a Mediterranean diet with nuts could cut stroke risk in nearly in half, though they were still having strokes. Half as many strokes, but you know, still a diet that promoted strokes and heart attacks. And so that's what, you know, Dr. Ornish noted when he wrote in. Look, there's no significant reductions in heart attacks, death from cardiovascular cause, death from any cause, didn't live any longer, just a stroke benefit. But look, hey, that's certainly something. Mediterranean diet is certainly better than what most Americans are eating. But even better may be a diet surrounding whole plant foods, which showed to actually reverse heart disease, not contribute to it. Well, that may be true, the authors of the study report, but the major problem with Ornish's diet is that it doesn't taste good, and so nobody will stick to it. But it's not true. Ornish got extraordinary adherence in his studies with no difference in any of the acceptability measures, or same enjoyment compared to the regular diet. Even got success in Barbecue County, rural North Carolina. See, stricter diets may mean greater acceptance among patients than modest diets because they may work better. Greater adherence means greater disease reversal. The most reversal of coronary disease stenosis was those who are most adherent to the diet. Just like any medical or surgical intervention, only works if you actually do it. But you don't have to be facing certain death. Even those who are young and healthy, no health problems, had no problem sticking to a plant-based diet. In fact, it worked a little too well. It was a crossover study where they asked people to eat a plant-based diet for a few months, then switch back to their original diet to note the contrast. But people felt so good eating healthy, some refused to go back to their regular diet, which messes up the study. You can't do the statistics anymore. They were losing weight with no calorie count and portion control. They had more energy. Their periods got better. Their digestion got better. Better sleep. They're like, no way, we're not going back. Screw you, we're out of here. But if doctors just presume patients won't eat this way, well, it'd be like a self-fulfilling prophecy. Just like smoking doctors are less likely to tell patients to stop smoking, and couch potato docs are less likely to prescribe exercise or things like fruits and vegetables, we need to role model healthy behavior as practitioners. This greatly enhances our credibility and effectiveness. Gone are the days of traditional authority when the fat physician dropping cigarette ash down his gravy-stained vest could credibly prescribe a change in behavior. One reason why plant-based diets could save so many millions is because the number one risk factor for death in the world is high blood pressure, leading to waste 9 million people year after year in the United States, killing off more than 1,000 people every day. 400,000 Americans dead every year. High blood pressure affects 78 million Americans. It's one in three of us, and as we age, our pressures get higher and higher on average, such that by age 60, it affects more than half, it affects the majority. So wait a second, it affects most of us when we get older. Maybe it's less a disease and more just kind of an inevitable consequence of aging. No, known for nearly a century that high blood pressure need not occur. Researchers measured the blood pressure of 1,000 people in rural Kenya. We had a diet centered around whole plant foods, whole grains, beans, vegetables, fruits, and dark green leafy vegetables. Up until age 40, their blood pressure is similar to that of Americans, Europeans, down around 120s over 80s. But as Westerners age, their pressures creep up, such that by age 60, the average American is hypertensive, 140 over 90. But what about those eating plant-based? Their pressures improved with age. Not only did they not become hypertensive, their blood pressures actually got better as they got older. This whole 140 over 90 cutoff is arbitrary. Just like studies show that the lower cholesterol, the better. There's really no safe level above about 150. Blood pressure studies also support a lower the better approach to blood pressure reduction. Even people who start out with a blood pressure under 120 over 80 appear to benefit from blood pressure reduction. So the ideal blood pressure, the no benefit from reducing it further blood pressure, 110 over 70. Wait a second, is it even possible to get our blood pressure down to 110 over 70? It's not just possible, it's normal for those eating healthy enough diets. Over 2 years at a rural Kenyan hospital, 1,800 patients admitted. How many admitted with high blood pressure? How many did they find? Zero cases of high blood pressure. Wow, they must have had low rates of heart disease. No, they had no rates of heart disease. Not low risk, no risk. Not a single case of arterial sclerosis. Our number one killer was found. Rural China, too. But 110 over 70 their entire lives, on average. Now look, Africa, China, very vastly different diets. One thing they shared in common was that they're plant-based day to day, right? With meat only eaten on special occasions. Now, why do we think it was the plant-based nature of their diet that was so protective? And that's because in the Western world, as the American Heart Association has pointed out, the only folks really getting it down that low are the strict vegetarians, coming in about 110 over 65. So, does the American Heart Association recommend a strict vegetarian diet? No, they recommend the DASH diet. The DASH diet has been described as a lacto-vegetarian diet. It's really not. It emphasizes fruits and vegetables, low-fat dairy, but just a reduction in meat. Why not? Vegetarian, we've known for decades that food of animal origin highly significantly associated with blood pressure. In fact, you can take vegetarians, give them meat, and watch your blood pressure shoot up. So when the DASH diet was created, were they just not aware of this landmark research done by Harvard's Frank Sachs? No, they were aware. The chair of the design committee that came up with the DASH diet was Frank Sachs. See, the DASH diet was explicitly designed with the number one goal of capturing the blood pressure lowering benefits of a vegetarian diet. Yet, contain enough animal products to make it palatable to the general public. In fact, Sachs knew that if you give vegans dairy, their blood pressures go up, and the more dairy they got, the higher the blood pressure, but they had to make the diet acceptable, right? The diet wouldn't work at all if nobody started eating it. That was the thinking, right? And so we can't tell them the truth. The best, the optimal, we can just kind of tell them this with this paternalistic, patronizing view that we know what's best. Instead of just telling people the truth and letting them make their own mind as to the compliance of themselves and their family. Recent meta-analysis Shows vegetarian diets are good, but strictly plant-based diets may be better. Vegetarian diets in general confer protection against cardiovascular diseases, some cancers, and death, but the completely plant-based diets seem to offer additional protection. Obesity, hypertension, type 2 diabetes, heart disease, mortality. Based on a study of 89,000 Californian state may have heard of, those who eating meat-free diets appear to cut the risk of high blood pressure in half, but those eating meat-free, egg-free, and dairy-free had 75% lower risk. If, however, you're already eating a whole food plant-based diet, you're still not hitting 110 over 70, there are a few plants recently found to offer additional protection. Randomized placebo-controlled trials showing that a cup of hibiscus tea with each meal significantly lowers blood pressure. In fact, tested head-to-head against a leading blood pressure drug, Captopril, 2 cups of hibiscus tea every morning, as effective as the drug, without the side effects and the cost. Another randomized placebo-controlled trial found a few tablespoons a day of ground flax seeds induced one of the most potent antihypertensive effects ever described by a dietary intervention. 2 to 3 times more powerful than instituting an endurance exercise program. Not that you can't do both. Red wine may help, but only if the alcohol's been taken out. Sorry about that. Raw vegetables or cooked? And the answer is both. Though raw vegetables may work better. Kiwi fruit did not seem to work at all, even though the study was funded by a kiwi fruit company. Maybe they should have taken direction from the California Raisin Marketing Board, which came out with this study showing that raisins can reduce blood pressure, but only, apparently, compared to fudge cookies, cheeses, and sugar oil. See, they know the big pharma trick of picking the right control group. That's how you do it. Next on the dreaded list is diabetes and vision loss. Go together because diabetes is the leading cause of middle-aged blindness, preventable middle-aged blindness. Even with intensive diabetes treatment, at least 3 insulin injections a day, these implantable insulin pumps, the best we can offer is usually just a slowing down of the progression of the disease. So we can slow down your blindness. But a half century ago, Kempner at Duke proved you can not just slow it down, but reverse it with an ultra-strict plant-based diet, mostly rice and fruit. 44 consecutive patients walking in with diabetic retinopathy, and in 30% of the cases, their eyes improved from like this to that. It's not supposed to happen. Diabetic retinopathy has been considered a sign of irreversible destruction. So what does that mean in real life? That means unable to read headlines to normal vision. How do we treat diabetic retinopathy these days? With steroids and other drugs injected straight into the eyeball. And if that doesn't work, there's always pan-retinal laser photocoagulation, where laser burns are placed over nearly your entire retina. Surgeons literally burn out the back of your eyeball. Why would they do that? Well, one of the theories is by killing off most of the retina, the little piece you leave behind may get more of the remaining blood flow. You know, when I see this, along with Kempner's work, I can't help but feeling that history has been reversed. Like, can you believe 50 years ago all we had was that barbaric burnout, your socket surgery, but whew, thankfully we know now we can reverse the thing with dietary means alone, but instead of learning, medicine seems to have forgotten. The most efficient way to prevent diabetic complications, of course, is simply to eliminate the diabetes in the first place, which is often feasible with a healthy enough diet. Plant-based diet beat out the conventional American Diabetes Association diet, head-to-head comparison, randomized clinical trial, without restricting portions, no calories or carb counting. A review of all such studies found the following plant-based diets for diabetics, better improvement compared to diets that include animal products, but this is nothing new. Successful treatment of type 2 diabetes with a plant-based diet demonstrated back in the 1930s certainly a diet centered around vegetables, fruit, grains, and beans more effective in controlling diabetes than all other diets. Randomized clinical trial after 5 years, no big change in the control group, but in the plant-based group, insulin needs were cut in half, and a quarter ended off all insulin altogether. But this was a low-calorie diet. Maybe the diabetes got better because they lost weight. I mean, to tease that out, what you need to do is take a study where you switch people to a healthy diet, but you feed them so much that they don't lose any weight. And then you can see if a plant-based diet had benefits beyond just all the weight loss. Well, we had to wait 44 years, but here it is. Subjects were weighed every day. They started to lose weight. They made them eat more food. In fact, so much food that some of the participants had difficulty eating it all. Oh, not more food. Okay. But they all eventually adapted, so no significant weight loss, despite restricting meat, dairy, eggs, and junk. Okay, so with zero weight loss, did the plant-based diet still help? Well, here's the before and after insulin requirements. The 20 people they put in the diet, this is the number of units every day they had to inject themselves before and after going on the plant-based diet. Overall insulin requirements were cut about 60%. And half of them were off insulin altogether, despite no change in weight. So how many years did this take? Was it 5 years like the other study? No, this was 16 days. Wow. So we're talking diabetics who've had diabetes for as long as 20 years, injecting 20 units of insulin a day, and then as few as 13 days later, they're off insulin altogether. Thanks to less than 2 weeks of the plant-based diet, diabetes for 20 years, then off all insulin in 2 weeks. Here's a patient, 15, 32 units of insulin, and then 18 days later on none. Lower blood sugar levels on 32 units less insulin. That's the power of plants. And as a bonus, oh, the cholesterol dropped like a rock down to under 150 in 16 days, just like moderate changes in diet usually only result in modest reductions in cholesterol. Asking people with diabetes to make modest changes achieves equally modest results, which is one possible reason why most diabetics end up on, drugs, injections, or both. Right? Everything in moderation may be a truer statement than most people realize. Right? Moderate changes in diet can lead to moderate blindness, moderate kidney failure, moderate amputations, maybe just a couple toes. Moderation in all things is not necessarily a good. The only thing better than reversing diabetes is not getting in the first place. The study that purported to show that diets high in meat, eggs, dairy can be as harmful to health as smoking supposedly suggested that people under 65 eat lots of animal protein 4 times more likely to die from cancer or diabetes. You look at the actual study, see that's not true. Those eating a lot of animal protein didn't have just 4 times more risk of dying from diabetes. They had 73 times the risk of dying from diabetes. And as one eats more and more plant-based, it appears to be the stepwise drop in rates of diabetes down to 78% lower prevalence among those eating strictly plant-based. Protection building incrementally as one goes from eating meat daily to less than every day, to just fish, to then no eggs and dairy either. Similar pattern was found for leading cause of vision loss among elderly, cataracts, suggests, look, it's not all or nothing. Any steps we can make towards improving our health can have appreciable benefit. But why? Why is total meat consumption associated with higher risk of diabetes, and especially processed meat, particularly poultry? Well, there's a whole list. Potential culprits in meat, yes, maybe animal protein, but maybe animal fat, or the cholesterol, the iron leading to free radical formation, leading to chronic inflammation. Advanced glycation end products, another problem. They promote oxidative stress and inflammation. And food analyses show the highest levels of so-called glycotoxins are found in meat. Here's the top 15 sources. Chicken, turkey, fish, beef, and then whatever these are made out of. Kind of get the idea. Though other foods from animal sources certainly can harbor these pro-oxidant chemicals, in this study they fed diabetics foods packed with glycotoxins like fish, chicken, and eggs, and their inflammatory markers shot up like tumor necrosis fat and C-reactive protein. Thus, in diabetics, dietary AGEs promote inflammatory mediators leading to tissue injury. The good news, though, is by restricting these kinds of foods, you can suppress the inflammatory effects. So these glycotoxins may actually be the kind of missing link between development of type 2 diabetes in the first place in the animal fat and meats. As well as Alzheimer's disease, the final disease on our dreaded list, dietary AGEs appear to be an important risk factor for Alzheimer's as well. If you measure the urine levels of glycotoxins flowing through the bodies of older adults, those with the highest levels go on to suffer the greatest cognitive decline of the subsequent 9 years. I can't even find a laser pointer on them anymore. It's really sad. As well as the greatest brain shrinkage, cerebral atrophy, all helping to explain why those eating the most meat have tripled the risk of getting dementia compared to long-time vegetarians. The bottom line is that the same diet that may help prevent other dreaded diseases, cancers, heart attacks, arthritis, stroke, diabetes, high blood pressure, vision loss, may also help prevent brain loss and Alzheimer's as well. You know, one disease that's not on the list is ALS, or Lou Gehrig's disease, which strikes healthy middle-aged people seemingly at random, holds little hope for treatment or survival. Although mental capacities stay intact, ALS paralyzes people, and most patients die within 3 years when they can no longer breathe or swallow. At any given time, an estimated 30,000 Americans are fighting for their lives. We each have about a 1 in 400 chance of in our lifetime of coming down with ALS. And it appears to be on the rise around the world. What causes it? Well, there's a neurotoxin produced by blue-green algae in our rivers, lakes, and oceans that ends up in seafood, which is currently a strong contender as the cause, or at least a major contributor, to ALS and maybe Alzheimer's and Parkinson's as well. Researchers in Miami found this BMAA neurotoxin in the brains of Floridians who died in sporadic Alzheimer's disease and ALS, and significant levels in 49 out of 50 samples from Alzheimer's and ALS patients. Same thing was found in the Pacific Northwest and in the brains of those dying from Parkinson's disease. You can also apparently pick up more of this toxin in the hair of live ALS patients compared to controls. So is this neurotoxin present in Florida seafood? How'd they get contact with it? Yes, both freshwater fish and shellfish, like oysters and bass, and out into the bay, into saltwater as well. Not just in Florida, up the eastern seaboard, into the Midwest. This could explain clusters of ALS that have been found around lakes in New Hampshire, or fish in Wisconsin, or blue crabs around the Chesapeake, or seafood eaters in France, or Finland's Lakeland district around the Baltic Sea, and building up particularly in fish, mussels, and oysters. There's a general consensus that these harmful algal blooms are increasing worldwide thanks to industrialized agriculture, which may increase the risk of this exposure to this neurotoxin, explaining the increase possibly in the instance of these horrible neurodegenerative diseases. With substantial and ever-growing evidence that the neurotoxin does play a role in the onset and progression of neurodegenerative diseases, the most important question is, at least they thought, what mode of activity does BMAA do? That's not the question. The question is, how do we reduce our risk? And we know the presence of this neurotoxin in the aquatic food chain could be a significant human health hazard, so until we know more, it may be prudent to limit our exposure to BMAA in the human diet, which means limiting our exposure to seafood. Now look, there's neurotoxins in the dairy supply too, which may explain the link between milk consumption and Parkinson's disease. High levels of organochlorine pesticide residues found in milk and the brains of Parkinson's victims, and other pollutants like tetrahydroxyquinoline, which is actually what scientists use to try to induce Parkinson's disease in primates. So maybe the dairy industry should start requiring toxin screenings of milk. Good luck with that. You could also just not drink it, but then what would happen to our bones? That's a marketing ploy. If you look at the science, milk does not appear to protect against hip fracture risk, whether you're drinking it as an adult or drinking it during your teen years. If anything, milk consumption is associated with a borderline increased risk, fracture risk in men. This is just a partial explanation for the long-standing enigma of why hip fracture rates are highest in populations with the greatest milk consumption. This enigma irked a Swedish research team puzzled why studies again and again have shown this tendency, higher risk of fractures with higher intakes of milk. Well, there is this rare genetic birth defect called galactosemia, where babies are born without the enzyme necessary to detoxify the milk sugar galactose. So they ended up with high levels of galactose in their bodies, and that led to bone loss. And so maybe the Swedish researchers figured, even in normal people that can detoxify the stuff, maybe it's not so great to be drinking it all day. So, and the galactose doesn't just hurt the bones, that's what the scientists use to recreate a premature aging in lab animals, slip them a little galactose, shortens their lifespan, causes oxidative stress, inflammation, brain degeneration. Just like the equivalent of 1 to 2 glasses of milk a day. But look, we're not rats. We got to put this to the test in people. And that's what they did. They looked at milk intake and mortality, as well as fracture risk, to test their theory. 100,000 men and women followed for up to 20 years, and milk drinking women had higher rates of death, more heart disease, significantly more cancer with each daily glass of milk. 3 glasses a day associated with nearly twice the risk of death, and they had significantly more bone and hip fractures as well. More milk, more fractures. Milk drinking men also, a higher rate of death, died sooner. But for sure, I did not see that on the Superman ad. I'm not sure exactly why Okay, so where does this leave us? What are the common threads? Well, if you look at the major dietary quality scoring systems, which have each been associated with improved longevity, lifespan, lowering heart disease, cancer risk, look, they only have 4 things in common. So different dietary quality scoring systems give you points for different things, but there's 4 things that each one of the major scoring systems have in common. They say, look, more fruit, more vegetables, more whole grains, more nuts, more beans. Nuts and beans were together in a group. Okay, so they're all built around this common core of a diet rich in plant foods, whereas opposite food patterns, high in animal foods, processed foods, like standard American diet, associated with higher rates. So we need to optimize the food environment to support whole grains, vegetables, fruit, and plant-based proteins. Taking the quality diet quality indexes to their logical conclusion, the most plant-based diet was the healthiest diet. But again, it's not all or nothing. We now have evidence that simple advice to increase the consumption of plant foods, decrease the consumption of animal foods, confers a survival advantage. Just giving that advice to patients is associated with them living longer. And boy, do we need it in terms of life expectancy. The U.S. is down around 27th of the 34 leading free market democracies. People in Slovenia live a year longer than citizens in the United States. Why? Most deaths in the United States are preventable and related to nutrition. According to the most rigorous analysis of risk factors today, this is funded by the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation, number one cause of disability in the United States, diet, which has now bumped tobacco smoking to number 2. Smoking now only kills about 500,000 Americans every year, but diet kills hundreds of thousands more. So let me end with a thought experiment. Imagine yourself a smoker in the 1950s. The average per capita cigarette consumption was about 4,000 cigarettes a year. Think about that. In the 1950s, the average American smoked 1/2 pack a day. Average person, 1/2 pack a day. Why? Well, the media was telling you to smoke. Famous athletes agreed. Even Santa Claus. Care enough about your throat if they want you to smoke. I mean, look, you want to keep fit. You want to stay slender. So you make sure to smoke and eat hot dogs to keep yourself trim, and eat lots of sugar to stay slim and trim. A lot better than an apple. I mean, sheesh. Though apples do confer apples do connote goodness and freshness. And we see many possibilities for a youth-oriented cigarette. This is an internal tobacco industry memo thinking, apples, apple cigarette. In addition to staying fit and slender and soothing your throat, for digestion's sake, you should smoke. I mean, no curative power is claimed for Philip Morris, but an ounce of prevention is worth a pound of cure, so better safe than sorry, and smoke. Blow in her face, she'll follow you anywhere. No woman ever says no. They're so round, so firm, so fully packed. After all, John Wayne smoked them until he got lung cancer and died. Even the paleo folks were smoking back then. And so were the doctors. Now, this is not to say there wasn't controversy within the medical community. Yes, some doctors smoke Camels, but, you know, other physicians preferred Lucky. So, you know, there was some disagreement. It wasn't completely earned. What was the government saying? They liked their Luckies, too. I mean, who wouldn't want to give their throat a vacation? Not a single case of throat irritation. How could your throat or nose be adversely affected when cigarettes are just as pure as the water you drink? And look, if you do get irritated, no problem. Your doctor can just write you a prescription for cigarettes. This is an ad in the Journal of the American Medical Association. The tobacco industry gave medical journals big bucks to publish ads like these. Not a problem, though. Philip Morris claims are from completely reliable sources. The AMA journal makes sure to tell everybody. So what did the American Medical Association have to say for itself? You know, like most medical journals, they accepted tobacco ads. They have yet to see a single autopsy with one lesion with a Marlboro label on it. Come on! So when mainstream medicine is saying smoking on balance, is beneficial, and when the American Medical Association is saying that, now where could you turn back then if you just wanted the facts? What's the new data advanced by science? She was too tired for fun, and then she smoked a Camel. Babe Ruth spoke of proof positive medical science, that is, when he still could speak before he died of throat cancer. Now, some of the signs did leak out and caused a dip from about 11 cigarettes a day on average to 10 cigarettes a day on average. But those who got scared could always choose the cigarette that takes the fear out of smoking, or even better, choose the cigarette that gives you the greatest health protection. Now, by some miracle, there was a smokingfacts.org website back then that could deliver the science to you directly, bypassing commercially corruptible institutions. Well, you would have become aware of studies like this. An Adventist study in California in 1958 that showed that non-smokers had at least 90% less lung cancer than smokers. But this wasn't the first. When famed surgeon Michael DeBakey was asked why his studies published back in the 30s showing a link between smoking and lung cancer were ignored, he had to remind people what it was like back then. We were a smoking society. It was the movies. Everybody did it. Medical meetings, one big heavy haze of smoke. Smoking was normal. So, back to our thought experiment. If you're a smoker in the 50s in the know, what do? With access to the science, you realize the best available balance of evidence suggests your smoking habit not such a good idea. So do you change or do you wait? Or if you wait until your physician tells you between puffs to quit, you could have cancer by then. If you wait until the powers that be officially recognize it, like the Surgeon General did in the subsequent decade, you could be dead by then. Took 25 years for the Surgeon General's report to come out. Took more than 7,000 studies and the deaths of countless smokers for the first Surgeon General report against smoking was finally released in the 1960s. Now you'd think maybe after the first 6,000 studies could have given people a little heads up or something? No. It's a powerful industry, right? So one wonders how many people are currently dying needlessly from dietary diseases. Maybe we should have stopped smoking after the 700th study like this. With so much money and personal habit at stake, you will always be dissenters. But given the seriousness of these diseases, some total of evidence, we shouldn't wait till putting these preventive practices in place. As a smoker in the 50s, on one hand, you had all of society, the government, the medical profession itself telling you to smoke. And on the other hand, all you had was the science. If you were lucky enough to even know about it. Know about studies like this. So now let's fast forward 55 years. There's a new Adventist study out of California warning Americans about the risks of something else they may be putting in their mouth. And it's not just one study. According to the latest review, the total sum of evidence suggests mortality from all causes put together, many more dreaded diseases, stroke, heart attack, etc., significantly lower those eating meat-free diets, less cancer, diabetes. So, instead of going along with America's smoking habits in the 50s, imagine you or someone you know going along with America's eating habits today. What do you do? All right, with access to the science, you realize the best available balance of evidence suggests your eating habit might not be such a good idea. So, do you change your eating habits or do you wait? If you wait until your doctor tells you to change between bites, it may be too late. In fact, even after the Surgeon General report came out, the medical community still dragged their feet. The AMA actually went on record withholding support from the Surgeon General's report. Could that have been because they had just been handed $10 million from the tobacco industry? We know why the AMA was sucking up to the tobacco industry, but why weren't individual doctors at least speaking out? There were a few gallant souls ahead of their term, as there are today, standing up against industries killing millions, but why weren't there more? Maybe it's because the majority of physicians themselves smoked cigarettes, just like the majority of physicians today continue to eat foods that contribute to our epidemic of dietary diseases. What was the AMA's rallying cry back then? Everything in moderation. Extensive scientific studies prove smoking in moderation, totally fine. Right? It's not true, but that was the right moderation. Today, the food industry uses the same tobacco industry tactics, like misinformation, twisting the science. The same scientists for hire, paid to downplay the risk of secondhand smoke and toxic chemicals. The same hired by the National Confectioners Association to downplay the risks of candy. And the same hired by the meat industry to downplay the risks of meat. Consumption of animal products and processed foods cause at least 14 million deaths around the world each year. 14 million people dead every year. It's not a failure of individual willpower, says the Director General of the World Health Organization. This is a failure of political will to take on big business. It's a formidable opposition, right? Most governments fail to prioritize health over big business, but guys, we learn from experience that the tobacco industry, a powerful corporation, can sell the public just about anything. There's one thing we learn. The tobacco experience, wrote one district judge, it's how powerful profits can be a motivator, even at the cost of millions of lives and unspeakable suffering. As Dr. Neil Barnard tried to get across in his editorial in the AMA's Journal of Ethics, plant-based diets can now be considered the nutritional equivalent of quitting smoking. How many more people have to die, though, before the CDC encourages people not to wait until open-heart surgery to start eating healthy as well? Just like we don't have to wait until our doctor stops smoking, to quit ourselves. We don't have to wait until our doctor takes a nutrition course or cleans up their own diet before choosing to eat healthier. It's not your doctor's fault, writes a group of prominent physicians. There's a severe deficiency of nutrition education at all levels of medical training. We're never taught it. Right, but what do we know? We know whole food plant-based diet proven to reverse our number one killer. Only diet that's ever been shown to reverse the number one killer in the majority of patients. Protects against type 2 diabetes, cancer. So how has this knowledge affected medical education? It hasn't. Despite the neglect of nutrition and medical education, the public continues to consider physicians as trusted sources. But if doctors don't know what they're talking about, they may be contributing to diet-related disease. To stem this surging tide of chronic disease, physicians need to become part of the solution, but we don't have to wait for this to happen. No longer do patients have to be so darn patient. Doctors no longer have a professional monopoly on health information. There's been this democratization of knowledge. So until the system changes, we have to take personal responsibility for our own health, for the health of our families, right? We can't wait until society catches up with the science because it's a matter of life and death. In 2015, Dr. Kim Williams became president of the American College of Cardiology. He was asked why he followed his own advice to eat a plant-based diet. I don't mind dying, Dr. Williams replied. I just don't want it to be my fault. Thank you, Dr. Williams. And December 8th, I forgot to bring these DVDs with me. I sold out down in Santa Rosa. But on December 8th, my new book is coming out, How Not to Die. I hope people will check it out and enjoy it. And of course, meanwhile, all my work is available free at nutritionfacts.org. Okay. Questions? Let's do it. Let's get some lights.
Roseanne. Thank you so much for your talk and for coming back. I showed your video to my department, and I've gotten another person to talk about it, and they were fabulous presentations, and people have actually said that they were trying to make changes in their diet.
Great!
So I really appreciate it. Could you please tell us, have you heard anything more about the multiple sclerosis randomized controlled trial from the United States?
They can't get it published. So they presented it as an abstract, and no neurology journals will take it. Now look, they don't have to get it published in neurology. Sure, they get published in so many journals out there these days, but they really want to affect the neurology community. So this is a testament for anyone who knows Dr. John McDougall, this would not surprise you at all. So what did he do? He's suing the journals. He's suing these neurology journals for refusing to publish his study. I have never heard of such a thing. That seems very, very bridge-burning to me. But that's where it is right now.
So what were the results?
So we don't know. So all we have is a presentation at a meeting. Said they had good compliance and that they had, we wonder what the scan showed. Did they actually have an improvement? It was a 12-month study. They had extraordinary compliance. The fact that they're pushing so hard to get this published presumes that the results are good, but wouldn't it be kind of nice to actually see the study?
Recommend that he publish it in the Permanente journal. There are no ads there. It is funded by Kaiser. The reviewers are excellent. They're very thoughtful, and they talk about the plant-based diets in quite a few of the
There's a dozen journals there. That would be an excellent option. There's lots of journals they can publish it in.
Over here, you're in there.
But, yeah.
I noticed that you provided some information with regards to I noticed that absent from that was any disease. I understand why. But my question is there any research to suggest that a plant-based diet
Yes, that is so cool. Okay, so Huntington's is a genetic disease, but it occurs kind of at midlife, and so you can find out if you have it or not, and then you have this horrible, nightmarish kind of life in front of you. But you're totally fine until then. So in terms of diet, in fact, in terms of pharmacological mainstream approach, it's all about delaying the onset of the disease. Because once you start downhill, it just gets worse and worse and horrible, and you die. What's surprising is that so the one dietary factor most associated with extending the time until onset, so preventing onset, early onset, is reduction of dairy. So reducing dairy can actually reduce, can actually extend the period of healthy life. And the reason we think, this is interesting, is actually maybe uric acid. So uric acid, we always think of uric acid in a bad way, because we think of it accumulating people's joints and causing gout. But actually, so uric acid is interesting. It's actually an antioxidant, and it's actually accessible to the brain, across the blood-brain barrier, and actually appears to protect against neurodegenerative diseases, Parkinson's, and Alzheimer's, and can delay the onset of Huntington's too. And dairy consumption actually changes the levels of uric acid in your body. And so this actually is a sweet spot, right? So it's like a double-edged sword. It's like iron levels, right? Too high is not so good, too low is not so good. Same thing with uric acid we're finding out, surprisingly. It's not just, well, let's get low. There seems to be this good spot where you have enough to protect your brain, but not enough that's crystallizing your joints, causing a very painful toe. And so they looked at all the various dietary groups, and those in plant-based diets had the ideal uric acid levels. So that's kind of an additional evidence in terms of preventing from neurodegenerative disease as well as preventing gout as well as uric acid and kidney stones.
A gentleman in the back?
Yes. I have cholesterol about 200, and I've been on the vegan diet for 4 to 5 years. Granted, I eat the vegan ice cream and the vegan chocolate and things like that. Is it the fats in those that is causing that?
So there's a couple things we can try. So first of all, anyone who comes to me with a plant-based diet with high cholesterol, leaving too much cholesterol in their blood, after getting just kind of a baseline diet, see what they're eating, make sure they're not eating a lot of plant sources of saturated fat. So there's rare, when you talk about saturated fat, you're pretty much talking about meat, dairy, junk food, but there's some rare cases of saturated plant fat. It's the tropical oils. So it's a coconut oil, palm kernel oil, not palm oil, but palm kernel oil, and cocoa butter, the fat that's in chocolate. So those three plant fats actually raise your cholesterol. So coconut oil, for example, increases your cholesterol, your LDL cholesterol, as much as lard does. So actually recently with this kind of coconut oil craze, I see all these vegans coming to me with really high cholesterol levels, and they're eating spoonfuls of this stuff because they've been sold as bill of goods by coincidentally people selling coconut oil. It's like they're eating a stick of butter. Well, of course their cholesterol is going to shoot up. Okay. So first thing I do is kind of a nice clean plant-based diet, right? Ideal whole food plant-based diet, unprocessed plant. Okay. And so I try that for a few weeks and then get retested. We have this sense in medicine that, come back in 6 months, get retested. That's because drugs take a long time to lower. With dietary change, within 2 weeks, you can see, in that 16-day study where dramatic drop, it was 16 days, so 2 weeks. So you can do these dietary tweaks and keep getting your, panels taken, and the relatively cheap test. Even now there's you can get something like you can buy it, CBS, like a little blood stick, instead of like cardio check, right? Where instead of doing blood sugar, you actually get your total cholesterol. And so you can like follow your cholesterol and be like, this week I'm gonna try eating peanut butter every day. I'll see what you whatever. Okay, so you can follow and kind of see if there's that. Okay, now if it's still not low enough, Then I would think about secondary causes of hypercholesterolemia. There's some non-dietary causes, so hypothyroidism can raise your cholesterol, abdominal obesity, there's a whole bunch of things that can, kind of non-diet or indirectly diet related, that you want to kind of test for and make sure you don't have. But if you're still too high, then it's not just about removing bad foods from the diet, which is saturated fat, dietary cholesterol, and trans fats, but adding foods that lower your cholesterol. Just like the hypertension, right? Cutting out all animal foods gets most people down perfect blood pressure. But if you don't, then okay, yeah, the hibiscus tea and the flax seeds, you know, there's some tweaks. Same thing can be done with cholesterol. David Jenkins, University of Toronto, the guy that invented the glycemic index, came up with this portfolio diet, which is the strictly plant-based diet. But having a portfolio of foods that lower cholesterol. So it includes viscous fiber foods, slimy foods, oatmeal, eggplant, okra, which lowers your cholesterol, has this side fiber. Once you eat nuts every day, you know, all these things. And they each individually lower your cholesterol a few percent, like 5%. Like, so if you eat soy, for example, lowers about 5%. But they all lower by different mechanisms, such that if you eat them all, you need this kind of portfolio of cholesterol-lowering foods, you can actually get the combined benefit and you get like a 40% drop in your cholesterol, which is like, you know, starting dose of a statin drop. I mean, that's pretty impressive. So that's what it is. So first you get rid of the junk, test, and then start adding on these, you know, these cholesterol-lowering foods, and you should get right down to target. And if you still don't, well, there's still other things you can try. You can phytosterol supplements. There's all of it. And then eventually you may end up on a statin. There's people with, you know, familial hypercholesterolemia. I mean, they usually don't live as long as you do, but you know, they die of heart attacks in their 20s. But they're just genetically, they have a mutation that leads to cholesterol receptors in their liver that don't pull cholesterol out of the blood effectively. In fact, that's how we got the Nobel Prize to prove that cholesterol is what causes heart disease, because they have these little kids dying of heart disease with cholesterol levels of, you know, 1,000. So anyway, lots of things to do, and if you're having problems, please feel free to contact me, or I mean, there's lots of great resources out there. But the worst thing you do is ignore it, right? I mean, you got to do something about it, right? Having cholesterol that high is not healthy.
Good.
I was just wondering, I know at Loma Linda University, they've got complete plant-based cafeteria. And I'm hoping that Kaiser can follow that model instead of offering
healthy food in the hospital. Where's going to be your return business from? Come on!
But, you know, it's kind of interesting. It's a long battle. You know, we finally got the fryers out of the cafeteria. Candy bars disappeared from the cash register, and soft drinks are down low. But yeah, there's still a long ways to go, and there has to be one plant-based option in every meal. So
that's better than progress. Most hospitals I've worked at.
Yeah,
yeah, no, so that's great.
Call my boss. Yes, go ahead.
Could you speak to the oil and does it contribute to the disease process?
Yeah. So you know, what about oil? So well. I don't encourage a vegan diet. I encourage a whole food plant-based diet. The reason I don't like the word vegan is because it tells me what you don't eat, but it doesn't tell me what you eat. So I can speak to these college campuses, and they have these vegans living off French fries and beer, you know, and they think they're, you know, and it's just okay. But what whole food plant-based, that actually tells you what you're actually eating, right? And part of that is not just the plant part, but the whole food part, kind of food as grown. And so unprocessed foods, kind of in my definition, nothing bad added, nothing good taken away. That's ideal. So you think about, you know, oil, so like walnut oil. You take a walnut, pack with nutrition, one of the healthiest things we can eat, and you throw away everything except just the oil, which still contains some, fat-soluble nutrients, some vitamin E still left in there, but all the fiber, everything else. I mean, just completely stripped it all away, and you're left with the oil. So oil to me is like the table sugar of the carb kingdom, right? So you take a sugar beet, packed with nutrition, right? It's a beet, right? And then you take away everything except just the sugar, right? And you're left with table sugar. And that's what you do when you get oil, particularly the most refined oils. And so it's a highly processed food, And so you take away, like, you take olive oil, you take an olive, which is a fruit, and then you squish it into fruit juice. But then it gets even worse, because then you take all the watery part of the juice, called olive wastewater, you dump it in a ditch, and you just get the oily component. So you just get a fraction of the nutrition found in the original olive. And that just kills me. It's throwing away all that good stuff. Ah, just makes me sick. So, I mean, I just love people to eat whole foods, get all that nutrition. And indeed, when you do studies looking at arterial function, endothelial function, where you do kind of ultrasound studies on the brachial artery in the arm, and you can actually see these acute effects of what you eat on arterial function. So eating the original study done by Vogel back, 20 years ago, was with sausage and egg McMuffins. Gave people sausage and egg, and within hours, they cut their ability of their arteries to relax in half, stiffen their arteries, and endothelial dysfunction, which is the lining of the arteries, which allows the arteries to dilate, is an excellent predictor of all sorts of really bad things. And so, you know, we have this thought that, oh, if I eat bad, you know, way off far in my future, years down the road, I'm not going to, you know, something bad's going to happen. But no, literally, within hours of it going in your mouth, as these adverts stiffens the entire vascular tree, including the arteries in your lungs, all these interesting things. So what happens when you give people olive oil? Yeah, the same thing. Give people extra virgin olive oil, same thing. Give people cheesecake, same thing. The fatty meals have this immediate acute deleterious effect on arterial function. We want to keep our arteries as functional as possible.
Perhaps one more? Emily?
Yeah, you know, we're talking about ALS and seafood. What about sea vegetables? Is that associated with ALS as well?
So the seafood only has this toxin because the big fish eat the little fish, eat the little fish, eat the little fish, who eat algae, which have the toxin, and builds up the food chain, kind of accumulates. So seaweed doesn't eat algae, right? Seaweed doesn't eat anything. And so none of the edible seaweeds produce this toxic compound. And so there's no BMAA in sea vegetables, like, you know, dulse or nori or things like that. And so excellent source of iodine and minerals, so one does not have to worry. Although there's ways you can get exposed to BMAA without eating any fish at all. There are supplements you can buy at the health food store, blue-green algae supplements, right? And so it's like, there's only a few places you can find this stuff in the world. In the brains of Alzheimer's patients and ALS patients, and at Whole Foods, sitting on the shelf, right there. And also, if you're an algae bloom and you're like swimming in the lake, you get exposed, things like that. But other than that, that's about it.
Thanks once again.
Thank you so much.